Hey everyone, welcome to the shorter version of my basic tutorial without the Lightroom section. If you don't use Lightroom, this is a tutorial for you. But also for those new to LRTimelapse, I recommend starting with this simplified workflow. Once you're comfortable then and have practiced it a few times, feel free to check out the complete basic tutorial link below to add the powerful Lightroom editing to your workflow. This will make your learning experience much smoother. In this shorter video, you will now learn to define and edit keyframes in LRTimelapse, apply Holy Grail compensations if needed, automatically calculate all transitions and deflicker your time lapses. The result will be a super smooth final video. Enjoy! First of all, each time lapse sequence must be stored in a specific folder. A folder with a time lapse sequence should not have any further subfolders. In the LRTimelapse settings, on the folder tab, you can configure the folders to be displayed in the tree. I would advise you to define the parent folders under which your time lapses are located here. This increases the overall performance and makes things more organized. Select any folder in the tree to load the sequence into LRTimelapse. Timelapse sequences can consist of raw, DNG or JPEG files. The workflow is the same for all these file types. However, the quality of the result and the processing speed is highest with RAW files. Therefore, you should use these whenever possible. Conversion from RAW to DNG is not necessary and it's usually counterproductive. You can playback your time lapse directly after loading it using the preview in the top corner. Those images are, of course, not yet edited. On the right side, there is a table with so-called metadata. Metadata is information about the images such as exposure time, aperture, and interval. The editing steps are also displayed as metadata in the table. Here, for example, in the column exposure, the exposure correction. The highlight of working with LRTimelapse is that all edits are first calculated virtually and only applied to the images in a single development process at the very end when the video is output. This lossless processing is one of the great advantages of LRTimelapse. It makes it possible to create time lapses in unique quality. When we play back the sequence, we can see how the light changes during the recording. The blue curve shows this brightness progression. The workflow buttons are located at the top of the screen. These buttons simplify working with LRTimelapse. Normally, you simply go through them from left to right, so you always know exactly what to do next. If you hover over a button with the mouse, you will see an explanation. Let's start with the Keyframes Wizard. Keyframes are those images that we are going to edit later. If you click on the Keyframes Wizard, you will get a suggestion for the number of keyframes, but this is only a rough guideline. You can easily change this number by moving the slider. To determine how many keyframes you need, simply look at the sequence and identify where you see significant changes. In this case, I think we will need one keyframe at the beginning, one in the middle, and one at the end. So in this example, we are going to have three keyframes created. If you need more, you can either use the slider or create keyframes manually by activating the keyframes icon on the left of the table. Another option is to press the one key when an image is selected. Next comes the so-called Holy Grail Wizard. This is intended for sequences that you have recorded using the Holy Grail method. This method has proven to be useful for recording day-to-night or night-to-day transitions. The timelapse is recorded normally in the camera's M mode, and exposure time and ISO are then adjusted as required when it gets dark or bright. This can be done manually or with the help of an app such as qDslrDashboard. There is a separate video from me on this. However, adjusting the camera exposure in this way during recording leads to a jump in the brightness curve. Multiple readjustments lead to a zigzag curve. The Holy Grail Wizard automatically compensates for this and makes appropriate corrections to smooth the sequence. The Holy Grail Wizard cannot be activated for sequences that were recorded without manual readjustment of the camera, as it's not required in this case and would be counterproductive. Now save the editing steps you have carried out as metadata. The images are not yet finally developed, but all processing steps are written to the so-called XMP files. LRTimelapse communicates with the RAW converter via these files. While the undeveloped camera previews are displayed in blue, the developed visual previews are displayed in pink. This applies to the icon in the workflow bar as well as to the luminance curve in the preview. You can switch between the camera previews and the visual previews using the visual previews button. The internal editor in LRTimelapse uses the same tools as Lightroom and Adobe Camera Raw. For simple edits or corrections, you can therefore save yourself the detour via Lightroom. The results are the same. Finer adjustments to the edits can be made using the plus minus buttons. Once you have finished editing a keyframe, you should transfer the settings of the edited keyframe to the next keyframe as a starting point so that you only have to make modifications there. Edit all your keyframes from left to right using the previous edit as starting point for the next. The next step is to calculate automatic transitions for all images between the keyframes. To do this, simply click on the auto transition. LRTimelapse now calculates the developments for all images between the keyframes and briefly displays the resulting curves. If you want to see the curves again, you can display them using the All button. The colors of the curves correspond to the headings of the table columns. Only curves and columns for actually animated tools are displayed. LRTimelapse now automatically creates visual previews for the entire sequence. Unlike camera previews, these visual previews have now been developed with your edits. When you playback the sequence now, you can judge if it's already perfect or if additional changes are required. Often at this stage, a sequence is not yet completely smooth, but shows a so-called flicker. You can see this during playback, but also on the pink curve, which then is not smooth. LRTimelapse can completely remove this flicker. To fully remove the flicker, it's advisable to set a reference area for the calculation of the luminance curve. This reference area should cover a part of an image that is not affected by natural desired changes in brightness, but instead shows the flicker as isolated as possible. This is often an area of the sky. If there are fast clouds in the sky or other objects passing by, then alternatively you should choose an area where less of those natural changes occur. The aim is to see the flicker as isolated as possible in the luminance curve. You can set the reference area by clicking and dragging on the preview. You can delete the area again by double clicking. After releasing the mouse button, LRTimelapse recalculates the luminance curve. Now activate the visual deflicker. Use the smoothing slider to set how much the luminance curve should be smoothed out. If this slider is set to zero, the target curve will follow all bumps and there will be no deflicker. The higher the slider is set, the smoother the curve becomes. Of course, the aim is to find a setting that smooths out short-term flicker, but maintains medium and long-term changes to the luminance. You can either choose a single deflicker pass or a multi-pass deflicker that makes two or more passes to gradually remove the flicker. In this case, we will set up two-pass multi-pass deflicker and then click Apply. LRTimelapse now calculates the deflicker for images that deviate from the green curve. Perfectly aligned images will not be recalculated. With multi-pass deflicker, several passes are made, with the pink curve getting closer and closer to the ideal green curve. On each pass, less images have to be recalculated. All these calculations are lossless, which means that you can perform as many deflicker passes as you like without affecting the quality. This is because all adjustments are initially only calculated as metadata. They are only applied once when the video is finally exported and rendered. This gives you a video of the highest possible quality. On the left-hand side of the tree, you can see so-called workflow indicators, which show you which steps you have already carried out on a sequence. Here you can see from left to right the symbols for keyframe, the Holy Grail Wizard, if applicable, the auto transition, the deflicker with the number of passes, and whether a sequence is already finished and has videos assigned to it. You can even detach the preview panel to have a larger view and better assess the preview. Exporting and rendering are two separate processes in LRTimelapse. When exporting, the images are finally developed and all processing steps are applied to the full-sized image files. The result of the export is a so-called intermediate sequence with developed image files, JPEG or TIFF. After that, this intermediate sequence is rendered, which means converted into a video. The reason for the split is that the time-consuming export process only has to be run through once. However, various video files can then be created from the intermediate sequence in different resolutions and with different post-processing options. Just click on Internal Export and Render. Now you will get asked for an export and render folder, which should always be separated from the folder that you use to store your original time-lapse files. Now that we are using a restricted folder tree, we are kind of limited in selecting another folder. So let's globally add the folder timelapse done to our restricted tree to make it available. It's a folder where all the exported and rendered timelapses will get stored. Now that I added it here, you also can see it in the main tree. Now select this timelapse done folder and click on export and render. The export dialog comes up in the orange mode, export and render current sequence. LRTimelapse offers some presets at the top left of the render dialog. These are also useful if you are not yet familiar with the specifics of video settings in detail. You can of course adjust these presets if necessary or add your own. For example, you can use the first preset to output a standard HD video at 29.97 frames per second, which is default. This preset uses the common H.264 compression algorithm. Videos that you create with this preset have maximum compatibility with any output device. Basic settings such as the video encoder, the dynamic range, the output size and quality, as well as the frame rate are made on the left. On the top center, you can see the automatically generated file name. This file name is updated according to the settings you have made. On the right, there are some settings for post-processing. For example, you can set a custom crop with a selectable aspect ratio here. You can use the slider to move the crop and you will see a corresponding rectangle in the preview. Another very useful tool is LRT Motion Blur. The Motion Blur will basically blend images that are next to each other. Setting of 5, for example, means that 5 images are blended. This produces a very beautiful, smooth result and also reduces noise. But the level of motion blur should always be adjusted to the content of the timelapse. With fast-moving timelapses or pans, exaggerated motion blur settings can lead to ghost images. In this case, you can simply re-render the video with a different setting. Higher motion blur settings, the addition of watermarks and timestamps are reserved for the Pro license. Now click on Render to output the final video. The rendering process is displayed in the batch processing list at the bottom left of LRTimelapse and runs in the background. Once the rendering process is complete, the video file is displayed in Explorer or Finder. To re-render another video from an intermediate sequence, you can just reopen the render dialog. Then you can change the settings and re-render, or you can just use the select button to return to a previously exported intermediate sequence at any time in order to re-render it again and try out different motion blur settings, for example. Exported intermediate sequences always start with the prefix LRT underscore and are displayed in blue in LRTimelapse. If you hold down the shift key when clicking on render, the render dialog will not be closed and you can immediately start the next render process. The exported video files automatically contain information about the render settings in the file name so that you always know which settings you have used and files with different settings are not being overwritten. The results are timelapses of incomparable quality. I hope this video helps you to get started with LRTimelapse. I would appreciate a like if it has helped you. You can find more videos on my YouTube channel. It's best to subscribe to it, of course, because new videos are always being added with lots of tips to help you get better and better at working with LRTimelapse. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to come to the LRT Timelapse Forum. Many other users write and read there, and I'm there every day to answer your questions. Thanks for watching and see you next time.